So last day, we have talked about the basic notion about the current mirror circuits, and also I have discussed about the advantages of having cascode current mirror. Now, while discussing the concept of current mirror, what I have mentioned, so there are two different aspects which you need to emphasize. The first aspect is that the current source should be properly defined. So whenever we have some reference current source, now we are just copying that current from the reference current source, then this copying operation has to be properly defined. In a sense, we can say that whenever we do a kind of copying, then the corresponding value should not be dependent on any other voltage. Moreover, there should not be any dependence on the technology dependent parameter. There should not be any dependence on the temperature. And moreover, there is another important attribute which we have mentioned last day, that is about the voltage headroom. We always want that whenever we are going to implement the current mirror circuit using MOS devices, then the voltage headroom occupied by the MOS devices should be as low as possible so that the available voltage swing can be made larger. In connection to that, we have last day come up with a solution. So let me just show you the circuit diagram with which we ended last day. A simple current mirror circuit. So we have some VDD, and then we have some reference current source, IDEF. So let me just show you the two circuits side by side and what are the comparative analysis between these two circuits. Then you can also understand. So in fact, we have this cascode stage over here, common source followed by common gate. Suppose this terminal is okay. So we have a diode connected circuit over here. So let me just call. Suppose this one is M1, this one is M2, this one is M3. So this point, this is a supply line, that is VDD. And this one is the reference voltage, reference current, that is IDF. And let me call this point as point P, and the drain current that is flowing through it, let this be represented by I out. And let me call this point as point A, and this point as point B. And suppose this potential, let me call like some V dashed. So the thing is that we have to ensure that this IDF upon I out, so that should be constant. So last day we have already emphasized that that ratio IDF by I out can be made like a ratio of 2 W/L. Apart from that, we have 1 upon 1 plus lambda VDS1 upon 1 plus lambda VDS2. Now, if these two potential, this A and B, the potential at point A and the potential at point B, if they are equal, then what we find is the drain to source voltage for MOS1 and the drain to source voltage for MOS2 will be equal. And assuming that the lambda being the same for each of these two MOS devices, then this factor 1 plus lambda VDS1 upon 1 plus lambda VDS2 comes out to be 1. And ultimately we have I reference as some constant into some I out. And if I can make this constant to be equal to 1, then I reference can be equal to I out. Now that description we have already made last year. And V dashed, as you know, this is the voltage which we apply at the gate of this common gate configuration. So M3 is acting as a common gate over here. So that's why this potential is fixed one. In AC equivalent circuit, this potential is equal to AC ground. Accordingly, we have to select the value of V dashed so that all these two transistors, this M2 and M3, they are kept in saturation. Because whenever you're talking about the MOS devices to be used as a current source, then obviously these devices must be operating in the saturation region. Now, you know, this value of VDAST can be arbitrarily selected so that these two devices are in saturation. So that was our first discussion. And then what we have done, we have modified this circuit. So let me just show you the circuit, the right-hand side. We have found out the corresponding value for VDAST so that these two devices are in saturation and the potential at point A and the potential at point B are kept to be same. So what we have done is we have just added another diode connected load over here in the left hand path so that the VB or this particular thing, let me just complete the circuit diagram first. Now we have this MOS acting as a common source, and we have another MOS over here. And this point is the point P, reference point P. So let this be I out. And we have added one additional MOS devices over here, that is M4, if I call this to be M4. And then this value of VDAST can be properly tracked. And then, as we have already discussed in the last day, that this circuit, the second circuit, the I out is strongly defined as compared to the first circuit, because in the first circuit, we have to tune the value of VDAST so that this condition, that VA equal to VB, that condition holds good. But in the second circuit, we know that we can properly define I out as a function of IDF. So this is not poorly defined. But we are paying an additional cost in the second circuit. What was the additional cost? The additional cost is coming in the form of the voltage headroom. So we have mentioned, I'm not going into the calculation today, we have mentioned that the minimum value of the potential at this particular point, VP minimum, was nothing but the summation of the overdrive voltage of these two MOSes, that is MOS 3 and MOS 2, plus some threshold voltage for the second circuit. For the second circuit, the VP minimum, so that both of these two MOS devices are in the saturation region, the minimum value for VP was like the summation of the overdrive voltages of these two MOS, M2 and M3, plus one additional threshold voltage. However, for this circuit, we know that this is nothing but simply the summation of two overdrive voltages. So as far as the voltage headroom is concerned, there is a certain trade-off that we are making. So if I just compare the first one with the second one, we find that, so let me call this the first circuit, this is the second circuit. In fact, second one is the modification of the first circuit. So in the first case, so VDAST is not defined, is not properly defined, or I can say is, or I can also say is poorly defined. VDAST is poorly defined. So from the circuit itself, you cannot know what is the value of VDAST. So accordingly, you have to tune the value of VDAST so that the condition is satisfied. So VDAST is poorly defined, but voltage headroom, voltage headroom is less here. That is the additional part, and that is a voltage headroom is less. However, for the second circuit, what we have seen, since already VDAST is obtained from this particular potential just by connecting another MOS in this particular configuration, so this is properly defined. So VDAST is properly defined. And accordingly, we have found out the condition. But here, voltage headroom is high. voltage headroom is high. So in fact, our objective is to make the voltage headroom as small as possible, and at the same time, the value of V dash should be properly defined so that this I out can be met as a function of I difference, as a constant function of I difference, like I out is equal to some constant multiplied with I difference. So which is not true in the first case. So that's why we have to modify this cascode current mirror circuit to some extent, so that both of these two criteria can be satisfied simultaneously. In fact, there is a trade-off between these two criteria. So that is all about the recapitulation of what we have discussed in the last class. Now let me just show you the first the circuit diagram, then you can understand. Let me just start with, sorry. Okay. Let me just start with the supply line. So we have some reference current source over here. If I call this as I reference, then once again we do have two MOS devices connected in this fashion. But here, the output of this combination that is obtained from this terminal, if I call this point as point X, for example, then the output is fed back to the input, or in other words, I can say that output and input is connected together. So output is obtained at this particular point, and this is also tied up with the input. So if I call this as MOS 1 and this as MOS 2, then this MOS 2 second MOS is acting as a common gate. So here I can expect that the corresponding potential, it can be like V dashed, a constant potential. Now, if I just look at this combination, first of all, you have to identify the condition for which both of these two MOS devices are in saturation. And obviously, it depends upon the value of V dashed. So first of all, if I just take a look at the second MOS, that is M2, then obviously this drain to source voltage should be greater than or equal to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, so that this M2 is in saturation. So to make M2 in saturation, if I want to ensure that M2 is at saturation region, the condition is that VB, if I call, let me just, okay, so this one is VDD, right? So the VGS minus the threshold voltage, overdrive voltage for the second MOS should be less than or equal to the drain to source voltage. So if I call this potential, let me call this potential as let this be, say, V double dashed. So gate to source minus threshold is nothing but V dash minus V double dashed minus VTH, and drain to source is nothing but VX minus V double dashed. So therefore, to make M2 in saturation, the condition is that this V dashed minus VTH2, it should be less than or equal to the drain potential over here, that is the VX. Now, what about VX? So VX is also, this point is also connected over here. So you can also say that VX is equal to VGS1. That means we can write like VTEST minus VTH2. It should be less than or equal to VGS1. And from that, we can say VTEST should be less than or equal to VGS1 plus Vt is 2. So that is one bound, that is the upper bound for V dash. And we have to also find out the corresponding lower bound for V dash. Now, if I call this potential to be V double dash, then once again, to make M1 in saturation, so this condition has to be true for making M2 in saturation. And to make M1 in saturation, the condition is that this V double dash, or rather, I can write VGS 1 minus VTH 1, get to source voltage minus the threshold voltage for the first MOS should be less than or equal to V double dash. Now, what is V double dash? So, V double dash is nothing but this potential minus the get to source potential. So, I can write V double dash, which is nothing but the source potential for the second MOS. So, this is nothing but the gate potential minus the gate to source potential. So, therefore, it should be less than or equal to V dash minus VGS 2. So, from that inequality, we can find V dash should be greater than or equal to VGS 1 plus VGS 2 minus VTH 1. So, from that, we can have the range defined for V dash, and the range is, it should be VGS 1 plus VGS 2 minus VTH 1. This entire thing should be less than or equal to V dash, which is less than or equal to VGS 1 plus VTH 2. Now, under this condition, we can say that both of these two MOS devices are in saturation. And accordingly, if I select any value of V dash in between that, then obviously we can expect that the current is remaining constant. Now, what happens over here? This condition holds good if and only if, as you know, this value is less than this value. That means, in order to ensure that this condition is true or this condition is valid, so I can write over here, the condition is that VGS 1 plus VGS 2 minus VTH 1, it should be less than equal to, it should be less than VGS 1 plus VTH 2. I think I'm just going outside the boundary. So let me just once again write it down. So the condition is that this lower bound should be less than the upper bound so that this inequality holds good. So the condition is VGS 1 plus VGS 2 minus VTH 1. It should be, this entire thing should be less than or equal to, or rather it should be less than, not equal to itself. Because if it is equal to, then you have only one value for V dash. So it should be less than VGS 1 plus VTH 2. So if this VGS 1 gets cancelled from both of these two sides, then we can say that VGS 2 minus VTH 2, this entire thing should be less than VTH 1. That means if the overdrive voltage for the second MOS, VGS 2 minus VTH 2, if this overdrive voltage is less than the threshold voltage of this MOS, then obviously this inequality holds good. And within that range, you can select any value for V dash. Now the obvious question which must come into your mind is that what is the utility of having this circuit? Why should I at all bother about this circuit? Because this circuit will be used to provide, or this circuit will be used as the copying circuit which we have discussed in the last time. So in fact, if I call this circuit, if I just once again go back to the previous slide, so that was the copying circuit over here, which we have discussed last day. We have two dart connected loads like that, or at least one dart connected load in circuit one. But this copying circuit now is being modified in accordance with this circuit. And with this copying circuit, let us now take a look at the overall current mirror circuit. And then we will try to identify the advantage associated with this particular circuit. So let me just draw the copying circuit first. So this is the reference current source. We have two MOS devices. And this is connected, this output is connected to the input. And we have, let me just take a different color. I think there is certain fine. This has MOS one, this has say this has MOS two, second MOS. And this one is VDD, and we have I reference over here. Now, this copying circuit will help to produce the same I reference to generate another current source. So it should be once again a cascode current source. So let me just draw the cascode current source over here. So you have a common gate and common source. So in fact, the current I reference will be copied over here. So if I call this as point P, and if the current that is flowing is I out, then this cascode current source will have the current equal to I reference. So the condition which is true, or which needs to be true, is that you have to connect these two gates together. So already that potential, if I call that potential to be V dash, already we have seen what are the corresponding upper bounds and the lower bounds pertaining to V dash. In fact, in the last slide, we have seen that it should be like VGS1 plus VGS2 minus VTH1, less than V dash, less than equal to VGS1 plus VTH2. And then it is being provided to this cascode current source. Now, if I call this as MOS3 and this as MOS4, then if I just compare these two device M1 and M3, we find that this gate to source potential of M1 and the gate to source potential of M3 is the same. So this is quite apparent from the circuit itself that VGS1 is equal to VGS3 because their gates are connected together and the source are also tied up. Now, what about M2 and M4? we find that for M2 and M4, their gates are connected together, but we know nothing about the corresponding source terminal. Now, let us assume that, or let us ensure that rather, that this gate to source potential of M2 is equal to the gate to source potential of M4. If we can ensure this condition, so that assurance can be obtained just by finding out the condition between the W by L ratio of these four devices, we need to ensure VGS2 must be equal to VGS4, because this is not directly obtained from the circuit itself. We have to ensure this particular condition. However, VGS1 is equal to VGS3, which can be easily seen from the circuit diagram. Now, let me just, under this condition, let me just write down the expression for the current. So we can simply write mu n C aux W by L1. And right now I'm assuming that all of them are having equal threshold voltage. Then VGS1 minus VTH whole square is equal to mu n C aux W by L2 VGS2 minus VTH whole square. And another condition is that mu n C aux W by L3 VGS3 minus VTH whole square is equal to mu n C aux W by L4 VGS4 minus VTH whole square. So there is a whole square term. So now if I just, if I call this as equation 1, this as equation 2, and if I divide equation 1 upon equation 2, then what I am getting, for the simplification, I am not writing down this one, because as you know, VGS1 is equal to VGS3, quite apparent. So if I divide the 1 by 2, then we have W by L1 upon W by L3, that is equal to, we have W by L2 into VGS2 minus VTH whole square divided by W by L4 VGS4 minus VTH whole square. So right now I'm assuming that all the MOS devices, they are having equal threshold voltage. So from that you can easily find out the condition which makes VGS2 equal to VGS4. So we have to ensure this condition, that VGS2 must be equal to VGS4. Otherwise the remaining discussion cannot be completed. So under this condition, so the condition, as you know, the condition is that W by L1 by W by L3, so that should be equal to W by L2 upon W by L4. So that is the condition. So if you can ensure that condition, that W by L ratio of these four MOS devices are connected by means of this equation, then VGS2 is equal to VGS4 is ensured. Now with this, let me just once again take a look at the value of V test, and let's consider the minimum possible value for V test. So if I just go back to the previous slide, and you will see that the minimum possible value for V test was like VGS1 plus VGS2 minus VTH1. Now with this, the minimum possible value for V test is like VGS1. So we can simply write VGS1 plus VGS2 minus VTH threshold voltage. Now, what about VGS1? So we can always write VGS1 to be VGS3 and VGS2 to be VGS4, because we have already proved that VGS2 can be made equal to VGS4 by means of this condition, and VGS1 is equal to VGS3 already. So therefore, this can be written like VGS3 plus VGS4 minus VTH. So that is the minimum possible value for VTEST. Now, if I just once again go back to this circuit, so as you know, this is the potential VTEST, because the same gate potential you are applying at the gate of MOS 2 and the gate of MOS 4. Once again, let us come back to our previous analysis. What should be the minimum value for a potential at point P? As you know, this VP minimum is nothing but this potential minus the threshold voltage, because this is the drain potential of MOS 4 and V dash is the gate potential. So if I write the minimum value for the drain potential, it should be the gate to source overdrive. It's nothing but V dash minus VTH. So already we have written like VGS3 plus VGS4. So therefore, this is VGS3 plus VGS4 minus 2 VTH. So therefore, this can also be written, or this can also be arranged like VGS3 minus VTH3 plus VGS4 minus VTH4. So now you see that the minimum value of VP can be written like VGS3 minus VTH3 plus VGS4 minus VTH4. That means the minimum value of VP, the minimum potential over here, can be written like the summation of the two overdrive voltages, unlike this circuit. So you started with this circuit. We have started with this circuit. So in this circuit, the minimum value over here was like the summation of the two overdrive voltages plus one additional threshold voltage. However, for this circuit, the minimum value of P, I mean the minimum potential at P, was like the summation of two overdrive voltages only. But the problem associated with this circuit is that the V test is poorly defined, so we cannot always ensure that I reference is some constant multiplied with I out. However, for this circuit, this is properly defined. Now, coming back to the modified circuit, what we find is this modified circuit, if we just consider this condition holds good, this W by L ratio of these four devices, four MOS, they are connected by means of this equation, then obviously, we can write that this I out and I reference, they are just the replica. We find that I out is equal to I reference, so it's properly defined, and at the same time, the voltage headroom can also be minimized by the threshold voltage. So last time it was like the summation of these two overdrive voltages plus additional threshold voltage, but this time this is nothing but the summation of two overdrive voltages only. However, there is one clause that we have not mentioned yet, that is how to define or how to find out the value for this VTEST. So far we have used it like VTEST, but how to find it out? We have mentioned that it should be like VGS3 plus VGS4 minus VTH, or VGS1 plus VGS2 minus VTH. So this is nothing but the summation of two gate to source voltage of a MOS minus one threshold voltage. So how to ensure that? So let me just go to the next slide to show you how to, I think, okay, I can also complete over here only. So in fact, we have to use some additional circuitry so that this v dash is defined. We do have one diode connected MOS. We have one diode connected MOS like this, whose gate and drain are shorted. And apart from that, we have another additional diode connected MOS device, is upper one. I think I can just use that. Yeah. This is also diode connected. Gate and drain are shorted. And this point is tied up to this input. Now, this potential over here, this is used as V dashed, what we have so far identified. So this completes the overall copying circuit. So I think I can use a different color to make sense that okay, I can use a different color over here. So these two are connected together. So well, let me call these as M1 and M2 as before, because we started with this M1 and M2. This M1 and M2. And already you have mentioned M3 and M4. So let me call this other MOS, like this be M5, this be M6, and this be M7. So for M5 and M7, the gate and drain, they are shorted together, and the drain of M7 is connected to the gate of M6. Now if I call this is VDD, and let this be I reference. Now if I assume that the I reference is moderately large, then the same I reference is flowing through this combination M5, M6, and M7. Now, if the gate to source overdrive for this MOS, upper MOS M7, if the gate to source overdrive is small, that means if VGS7 minus VTH7, if this is very small, that overdrive is small. In fact, this can be made small by making W by L ratio very large, because the constant current is flowing, I reference is flowing, that is fixed. However, the gate to source overdrive for the different MOS devices are different, M5, M6, and M7. They are having different gate to source overdrive, VGS5 minus VTH5, VGS6 minus VTH6, and so on. But the same current is flowing. So as long as the current is fixed, current is constant. And then if I want to make this overdrive small, that can only be accomplished by making this W by L ratio for this upper MOS, that is MOS 7, M7, large. So that can be ensured by making W by L7 large. Now, what is the advantage you're getting out of that? Now, if this gate to source overdrive is small, then the potential drop from this point to this point is close to the threshold voltage. Then what about the potential at this point? Now if I call this point as say point, let me like say V1, okay, let me call V1. Then what about the potential at V1? In fact, remember that this V1 is connected to the gate of MOS 2. So I think it will be better if I use the same nomenclature. So instead of mentioning it like V1, so we have previously we have used like V-dashed. So it will be better if I call it like V-dashed. So this potential is V-dashed. So this V-dashed is obtained from this M5, M6, M7 combination. So how to define V dash? So V dash is nothing but the drain potential of MOS 6. And for MOS 6, we can simply write this VDS 6 to be equal to VGS 6 minus VTH 7, because this drop is close to the threshold voltage. Therefore, this potential can be written like this potential minus the threshold voltage. Then what about the absolute potential V dash? Because we have written like the drain to source potential. So V dash is the absolute potential with respect to ground. And we have already got VDS 6, that is the potential drop between this point and that point, between the drain and source of MOS 6. So therefore, this potential V dash can be written like this VDS 6 plus you have VGS 5 simply, because this drain and gate, they are connected together. So I can simply write V dash to be VDS 6 plus VGS 5. So that means VGS 5 plus VGS 6 minus VTH 7. Now, if this VGS 5 and VGS 6, if they are, they can be equated to VGS 1 and VGS 2 respectively, then the form which we are looking at, that this potential V test should be in the form of the summation of two gate to source voltage minus some threshold voltage. So in this form, VGS 1 plus VGS 2 minus VTH. So that can be directly obtained if I arrange the MOS devices in this particular fashion. So therefore, we can directly get V test from this. So in fact, this combination, these five MOS devices, M1, M2, M5, M6, and M7, these five MOS devices will constitute the copying circuit for this current mirror. And then obviously you do have this current source M3 and M4, which will just simply copy the current from this I difference. So I think with this, we can touched upon all the issues pertaining to a simple current mirror. Now, while discussing this notion of current mirror, we have mentioned one thing, that this current mirror circuit is used to copy a current source. So we do have some reference current source in our integrated circuit, and this reference current source is being copied. So therefore, it is used as a biasing element. So we know that everywhere we have to use this current source in the analog MOS circuit design. And the current source is generally being represented by means of the MOS devices. So we have the current source load. If I just once again remember the common source configuration, there you have seen that instead of having a simple resistance connected between the drain and the VDD supply, we can always employ one diode connected load, or we can always employ some current source load. And this current source load is being realized with the help of MOS devices. And moreover, whenever we talked about the differential amplifier in the last unit, there you have seen that we have some tailing current source. We have two MOS devices, M1 and M2, and their sources are tied up together. And then there is a tailing current source. Now, this tailing current source can also be represented by means, or can also be realized by means of one MOS devices. So now, apart from realizing those current mirror circuit as a passive one, as a biasing element, we can also employ this current mirror topology as an active load. So what do you mean by the active load? So far what you have discussed, we have some reference current source, and our basic objective is to copy the current I reference to the other parts of the circuit by means of some current mirror topology. So therefore, this I out is treated to be constant with respect to time, because that is the characteristics of any ideal voltage source or current source. You know, for an ideal voltage source, so the voltage should be remaining constant with respect to time, and for an ideal current source, the current amplitude should be remaining constant with respect to time. So there should not be any fluctuation, there should not be any variation. So as long as our discussion is concerned, so far we have assumed that this passive kind of current mirror circuit, that means the current is remaining constant, and that depends upon the reference current source. Now we can also employ this current mirror topology as an active load. Now let me just consider a simple differential amplifier pair which we have completed a few days back. You know, for differential amplifier pair, we should have two MOS devices, M1 and M2, and they will amplify the corresponding differential signal, and the corresponding outputs are obtained just by the method of subtraction. Now, as far as the load of this differential amplifier is concerned, we can have different types of load. We have started with a simple resistive load like this RD, and gradually we have seen that this RD can also be represented by means of MOS loads. In fact, we have considered two different types of load. One was a diode connected load, and the second one was like a current source load. So let me just show you once again the differential amplifier with a current source load. So this is acting as the load, this PMOS load we have. And we have these devices, two NMOS devices, which are acting as the input device for this differential. Okay, let me just modify this one. It's not connected to ground, rather, in order to make sense that this input CM variation does not affect the corresponding output common mode level. So we should have a tailing current source over here. So let me name the different terminals one after another. So as you know, this is the tailing current source, that is ISS. Let me call this as MOS1, this as MOS2, which are acting as the amplifying device or the input device. And apart from that, let me call, I think I can just shift the naming, because ultimately we do have a biasing, so current source load, and suppose this is M3 and this is M4, and we have a PTV supply. And as you know, we have two outputs, one from this terminal, the second one is from this terminal. So if I call this as X and this as Y, and then the output of the differential pair is nothing but Vx minus Vy, and accordingly you can find out the gain. So if I call this as the input 1 and this as input 2, which will vary in equal and opposite proportion, that means if I observe Vin1 to look like that, then Vin2 will look like that. Then the gain of this differential pair is defined like Vx minus Vy upon Vin1 minus Vin2. Now suppose we do have this differential pair, and as you understand, for differential pair, the output is measured between two points. So it's not a single ended output. So we have two different nodes like X and Y, and none of the nodes are having a constant potential. So none of them are treated to be AC ground because the potential, the small signal variation is present at node X as well as node Y. And accordingly, we have to supply this differential output to some successive stages. Now, let us assume that we do have another successive stage like this. Suppose this is one stage of amplification, this is one stage. And then suppose we do have another stage. Let me just show the amplification or amplifier by means of simple this notation. And let us assume that this particular amplifier also accepts the differential input. That is fine. So if this amplifier, so obviously there is certain discrete elements within that particular amplifier, but I'm not going into the details of that. Let me just symbolize the next stage of amplifier by means of this symbol. And let us assume that it is accepting the differential input. That means there are two different nodes to accept the input, this one and this one. Then there is no problem. We can simply connect this point to this point and this point. But what happens if the next stage is having a single node? That means if the next stage of amplification is a single-ended amplifier, just like this, then what happens? Now, in this stage, you have two different nodes like X and Y, and you know that the overall gain of the amplifier, the overall gain for the differential amplifier is written like Vx minus Vy upon Vin1 minus Vin2. And in fact, both of them, if I just consider this stage and this stage, so both of them are providing the same gain. So if I call this gain to be, say, 10, say Vx minus Vy upon Vin1 minus Vin2, so both of them are providing the corresponding gain. So if you can remember, the expression for the gain was like Gm times Rt. In one case, you have minus Gm times Rt, in another case, you have plus Gm times Rt. So now if you just observe, or if you just compare this gain with the single-ended gain, then you find that that can be written like this is the twice. This is nothing but the twice of the single-ended gain, that is Vx upon Vin1 minus Vin2. Now, you have a single-ended amplifier in the successive stage. Now, you do have only one input, one node to accept the input from the previous stage. But the previous stage already, it is having two different nodes to produce the output, that is X and Y. Now you can say that, okay, but I'm just leaving about this Y and I'm just connecting this X over here. Then what happens? If you just simply connect over here, I mean, if X is connected to this particular terminal and if Y is made floating, then what happens? The gain that you are supplying to the next stage is going to be halved. Because that is a relationship. Then what can be done? You have to ensure that you do have, or you should have, only one terminal to accept the input, but your differential amplifier produces a kind of output for which there are two terminals, X and Y. And if you just avoid any of the terminals, then the gain that you are feeding to the next stage will be just the half. So what can be done to get rid of this problem? So to get rid of this problem, obviously, from this circuit, you should have generate only one terminal. And obviously, this current source kind of loading has to be modified. Now, let me just first show you the circuit, and then I'll be explaining what is the working principle of this particular circuit. So in fact, that circuit which we have just now discussed, in fact, it was also discussed in the last unit. So as you can understand, this this circuit is symmetric in nature. So therefore, you can always apply the half circuit concept to find out the gain. But the circuit which I am now going to discuss is not at all a symmetric one. In fact, instead of using the current source load, it involves a kind of current mirror as an active load. So let me just start with the current mirror topology. Now you have the PMOS device on the top, and which is direct connected. And this current gets copied over here, another PMOS current source we do have. As you understand, this is nothing but a simple current mirror circuit, and it acts as a load over here. And apart from that, we do have two amplifying MOS devices, and ultimately the current source, tailing current source. So right now I'm just showing the tailing current source with the aid of the symbol only, but in fact you have to realize this current source by means of another MOS device. So this is the circuit. So let me call this as MOS 1, this as MOS 2, this as MOS 3, which is the PMOS, and this as MOS 4, which is also PMOS. And the supply is VDD. And the input that you're applying over here is VIN 1, and the input that you're applying over here is VIN 2. And now let us call that we'll be taking the output from this terminal only. So this is the only output terminal, that is a single-ended terminal, Vout. Then you have to analyze this particular circuit, that whenever you do have a variation like this. So if I call, the variation looks like this. VIN1, let me just call. VIN1 goes like this, and VIN2 goes like this. Then what will be the implication of this current mirror circuit in the load over this Vout? So before saying anything about that, let me just tell you the name of the circuit. So this is known as the differential pair with active load, or active current mirror with active load or active current mirror. So current mirror is used as a load over here, current mirror. So what is the significance of the term active? In fact, last time what you have seen is all the current mirrors, what you have discussed, the different topology. So their sole purpose is to copy the current. To copy the current with confidence. That means whenever there is a reference current source, so the current mirror circuit, the copying circuit, will help you to make a replica of I reference. And in fact, that was used for biasing purpose only. And that I reference was constant throughout the time. But here, what we find, the gate to source potential of this MOS M1 and this MOS M2, they are varied with respect to time. So here we are supplying the gate to source potential, which looks something like that. So plus delta V for VIN1 and minus delta V for VIN2. So you have equal and opposite excursion as far as the property of the differential pair is concerned. So therefore, the current which is flowing through this MOS M3 is also a function of time, because these two devices, so they are in series path, M1 and M3. So because of this time varying voltage applied at the gate terminal of MOS 1, the current that is injected over here, so you can always visualize this one. If I may just simply write, okay, it looks something like that. I'm just drawing the equivalent mode. So basically it looks something like that. So this is your MOS, that is M3, VDD supply. Now there is some certain current that is flowing, and this current is not constant. So now I cannot write like simply I reference. Rather, this current is a function of time. So I can write like some I1 plus some delta I1, just like this. I1 plus delta I1. So obviously the current that is flowing through this MOS is not a constant quantity. It depends upon the time. It's a function of time. And this is also true for the second MOS, I mean, this MOS M4, because this MOS is just copying the current from this current mirror circuit, because for each of them, M3 and M4, the gates are tied up together and the source are connected to the respective supply line, that is VDD. So therefore, for these two devices, they are acting as a current mirror. So the current that is flowing through M3, the same current is copied through M4. But the only difference is that this time, the corresponding current is not fixed. It varies with respect to time. So that's why it is known as an active load or active current. Now, to understand the notion of this particular circuit, so let me just show you a few such observations. Now, today, my plan is to discuss the qualitative part, and the quantitative calculations hopefully may be done in the next class. Now, just let me just show you some of the observations, and then you can analyze this circuit. This differential pair with the active load current mirror can only be analyzed if you can understand these observations. Now let's start with the first observation. Suppose we do have this MOS M1, and we do have another MOS M2. For which the corresponding inputs are V in one and V in two respectively. I'm just drawing the lower half of the differential pair, that is ISS. And suppose we do have one current source. Suppose this one is VDD. Suppose this one is V in 2 and this one is V in 1. So let me call the name. Suppose this one is M1, this one is M2, which are used as the amplifier over here. And we are interested about this potential, that is V out. So let me just orient it properly. So this one is V out. So we'll be taking the output from this terminal, single-ended output. But we don't know what is there. So this part is kept as a mystery. So there is nothing has been told over here what will be there. You just, with this incomplete circuit, let us try to understand what is the implication of the change of V in 1 and V in 2 on the corresponding output potential. So let us assume that this V in 1, this the gate potential, gate to source potential over here, suppose it increases by some amount. So suppose there is an increase by an amount, say delta V, a positive delta V excursion over here. And similarly for V in 2, let us assume that the negative delta V excursion, just like this. Now you have to understand what is the implication of having this variation of V in 1 and V in 2 over this V out, that is output potential. Now initially, let us assume that both of these two MOSes, they are having the same common mode level. Suppose the common mode level is V in CM, so they are having the same common mode level, and therefore the ISS, the current which is the combination of the total frame current, is equally divided between these two MOS, M1 and M2. Now suppose there is an increase in V in 1 by an amount of delta V, and a corresponding decrease in the amount of V in 2 by the same amount, that is delta V. So therefore, the current share of this M1 will be large as compared to that of M2. So we can say from this input plus delta V at V in 1 and minus delta V at V in 2, so less current will be drawn by the second MOS, that is M2. more current will be drawn by M1 and less current will be drawn by M2. So the current, if I call this current to be I2, so this current is reduced. Then what is the implication of reduced current over here? So in fact, you can visualize this M2 as a simple common source state. And for simple common source states, you have a current source load over here. And if the current decreases with respect to time, then obviously the value of Vout will be increased. So what we are getting from here, we will see that the Vout will be increased because the current that is being flown through M2 will be reduced because we are applying some plus delta V at V1 and minus delta V at V2. So Vout will be increased. So that is the one observation of the first observation. Now, I think since the observations are different, so it will be better if I just go to the next slide. And show you some other aspect pertaining to the current source. Now, suppose let me just show you. The implication of having this type of circuit. So we have a diode connected device. And in fact, it's a part of the current mirror circuit. The current gets copied over here. And on the top of that, suppose we have some PMOS current source. So we have some supply VDD. And suppose this potential, let me call VB. Let me call this as M1, this as M2, and say this as some I1. Now remember, this time this I1 is not constant. This I1 will vary with respect to time. Now suppose initially this is the combination, and as you can simply understand that the gate to source potential for these two MOS, M1 and M2, they are being the same. Gates are tied up together, so therefore this will this circuit will just copy the current that is being flown over here. But remember, this I1 is not fixed now. Rather, I can regard this current to be like some I1 plus some delta I1. So that is the fluctuation. So initially we have some I1, and now some increase in the current is observed. Then what is the implication of having the higher current? As you understand, this M1 and M2, this M1 M2 pair, it will just copy the current that is being flown through this combination. Initially, the current was like simply I1. Now the current is I1 plus delta I1. So since this circuit will copy the current, so therefore, because of the increase in I1 by an amount of delta I1, the corresponding increase can also be observed over here. So if I call the current that is being flown, if I call this current to be say I2, obviously I2 will just copy the current, and this was the terminal which you're talking about. Say let me call this as Vout. So you find that the current will be increased. Then what about this output potential? So we have a common source state and the amount of current gets increased. So therefore, we find that if there is an increase in current, if delta I1 is positive, if delta I1 gets increased plus, then the same is true for delta I2. Delta I2 will also be increased. And as a matter of fact, the Vout will be reduced because we have a simple common source state over here. It's a simple common source state. Now let us do the reverse operation. That means let us just make this current source by means of simply a PMOS device. I think I can Okay. Let us just make it just upside down and let us just construct this current mirror circuit using PMOS devices. So we do have this MOS. For which the gate and the drain are connected together, and this is being provided to the gate of the another MOS, which is obviously P-type. And we have an NMOS over here, which is being fed by means of a constant potential. So in fact, this is acting as a simple current source, this one, this MOS. If I call this as MOS 1, this as MOS 2, so M1 and M2, so they are forming the current pair, current mirror. This pair, M1, M2, they will form the current mirror circuit. And let me call, we do have a current source, for which there is a variation. That means we have some I1, once again, we have some I1 plus certain delta I1. So it is not fixed. So suppose this is another MOS, that is M3, which is acting as a simple current source. Now, what is the implication of having positive delta I1? Suppose initially the current was I1 and now the current has been increased by some delta I1. Then obviously, since the drain current for M1 is increased by some amount, automatically it will be copied over here, and accordingly the current through M2 will also be increased. Now remember, now since this potential is fixed for M3, it is not acting as a common source stage, rather it is acting as a simple impedance, because we have modeled this M3 just like a current source. So current source can always be regarded, can always be visualized by means of some resistance whose value is large. And this is the terminal from where we are taking the output, and rather we are interested in knowing the status of this particular node. Now here we find that because of some increase in delta I1, whenever delta I1 gets increased, you can expect that the delta I2, if I call this current to be delta I2, then delta I2 will also be increased. And what about Vout? So Vout is nothing but this delta I2 multiplied with the resistance. So here, the Vout will also increase. So you'll be having some different notion. Using NMOS current mirror and PMOS current mirror. For NMOS current mirror, what you have seen, if you just increase delta I1, then the corresponding Vout will be reduced, because here M2 is acting as a common source stage. However, for this one, what we find is whenever there is a corresponding increase in delta I1, then the Vout will be increased because delta I2 is also getting increased. So now with this two observations, in fact, we have made three observations, these two together and this one. Now with these three observations, now let us go back to the previous circuit, I mean this differential pair with the active load. Now let us assume that we have this V1, let us assume that we are applying a pulse kind of waveform over here. So some positive delta V excursion over here and some negative delta V excursion over here, to make sense that it is increased by some amount and it is reduced by the same amount. Then what is the implication? So first of all, let us assume that we are just applying this particular thing. We are just changing V1 by some amount delta V, and let us try to identify the observation which is applicable to analyze this scenario. So what we find, we have this kind of current mirror circuit made of M3 and M4 PMOS devices. Out of them, one is the diode connected, as obvious. And then we have the corresponding increase in the gate to source potential of a MOS device. Now, what is the implication of having a corresponding increase of delta V? The current that is flowing through the MOS M3 will be enhanced because of the increase of delta V. That is quite obvious, because the gate to source potential of the MOS is increased by some amount. So therefore, the drain current, which is flowing through this MOS M1, will also be increasing. So first of all, you have to identify the corresponding observation, which is properly applicable over here. So this is the observation. We have this in the differential amplifier mode, differential pair. We have mentioned these two devices like M3 and M4. So in fact, they are named as M1 and M2 in this particular circuit, but eventually they are the same. They are doing the same operation, and they are connected to some current source. In fact, we can visualize that the drain current of this particular MOS is not fixed. It gets varied by some means. So the same operation can also be visualized over here. We can always visualize that, okay, we do have a current source over here. We do have a current source over here between these two terminals. And the current source value is some I1 plus some delta I1. The same thing, we have some P-type current mirror circuit over here, M3 and M4. And this is not fixed. The amount of current which is being flown through M3 or M4 is not fixed. That is varying with respect to time. Then because of that, because of the corresponding increase in the delta V, what about the status at V out? So once again, let us just observe if there is a corresponding increase in delta in I1. That means I1 has been increased by an amount of delta I1. What is the implication? We find that V out gets increased. So the thing is, because of this one, this delta V1, rather delta V, the corresponding V out will be increased by some amount. That is fine. I think it will be better if I just change the color of this particular thing. I think what I can do is I can take a different color to make sense. Now, suppose let me just consider the second scenario, in which case the gate potential at M2 gets reduced by the same amount, that is delta V. Then if I just reduce the gate potential over here, what is the implication over here? What is the implication over V out? So then once again, you have to identify the observation which is applicable, and this is the observation which is applicable. You have seen that if delta V reduced by some amount, I mean, if V into is reduced by some amount, say delta V, then the corresponding V out over here also gets increased. And you have this kind of P-type current source, and which is also true in this case. So this analysis of these observations can be applicable while V into gets reduced by an amount of delta V. So what is the implication? The implication is that if V into gets reduced by some amount of delta V, the corresponding V out gets increased. So because of the reduction in delta V, V out also gets increased by some amount. So what we find whenever we do apply these two together, that means V in one gets increased by delta V and V in two gets decreased by delta V, then both of them are having the same implication. Both of them are having the same significance on the V out. Both of them are trying to increase the value of V out. So we can visualize this one from two different perspectives. One is when we apply some V in one at the gate of MOS one, and the V in one gets increased from its common mode level by some amount, by some differential amount, then the corresponding implication is the enhancement of V out.
And so that can be treated from this perspective, that because of the increase of delta V, the current gets increased in this particular path, and it gets copied by this NCM4 current mirror circuit, and accordingly the V out value gets increased. And the second one is whenever you apply V into and you reduce V into by some amount delta V, then following a different analogy which we have made over here, since the gate potential is reduced and it is acting simply as a common source state, so the gate potential is reduced, so obviously the drain potential will be enhanced because it is acting as an inverter. This M2 acting as an inverter, where M4 is acting as a load for this common source state. So therefore we do have another additional observation resulting from this, and they will be having the same implication. So both of them are trying to enhance the value of V out in the same direction. So whenever we apply this plus delta V at V1 and this minus delta V at V2, then both of them are trying to increase the value of V out and in the same direction. However, you cannot analyze this circuit using the half circuit concept, which we have discussed perhaps in the last unit, in the last class on a differential amplifier. So in fact, the amplifier which we have discussed over here also, that is the basic differential pair with the current source load. Remember, while analyzing this circuit, we have taken the help of the half circuit concept. So that is only possible because the left hand side and the right hand side, they are symmetric in nature. So you have these two MOS devices as the input device and these two MOS devices as the load device, and they are symmetric in nature. So if I assume that the properties of M1 and M2 and M3 and M4 are identical, then we can apply the half circuit concept. And under this condition, this potential is kept fixed, and we can consider that this potential is equal to AC ground. However, this half circuit concept is not at all applicable for this current mirror load or for the active load, because now we can see that this M3 and M4, they are not identical. The topology is different. M3 is a direct connected form and M4 is just copying the current from M3. So we cannot apply the notion of half circuit over here. And so therefore, it has to be treated from a different perspective, from different analysis. And one thing which we have understood from today's discussion is that if we do this kind of variation, both at the gate of M1 and at the gate of M2, then the corresponding V out is going to be increased in the same direction. However, we have to check whether the corresponding enhancement is by an amount of 2, so that this factor 2 is restored, because now we don't have two different terminals to provide. We have only one terminal. We don't have X and Y. We have only one terminal, this V out. Now, to make sense that this 2 is restored, then the corresponding gain over here must be the twice as compared to the individual gain. So that thing can be obtained quantitatively if we perform the small signal analysis. Hopefully, I'll be covering this one, this small signal analysis of this differential pair with active load in the next class. In fact, that mathematics is very tedious, and you have to be very much attentive in understanding the different parts of the mathematics. So anyway, with this qualitative discussion today on the differential pair with active load, so I can conclude our today's discussion on this current mirror circuit.